there was a time before my MBA where I used to go gaga over buffets, right? Like buffets used to be a huge thing, right? Now, like ghar ka khana is the best.
A lot of people will definitely naturally have this question, like when you are driving, when you have the steering wheel, how much are you getting compensated and what exactly are the roles and responsibilities assigned to you that you are contributing to the company?
So I think in terms of compensation, it was industry standard for someone like really starting out at a big four consulting firm as an analyst, right? And the expectations, I think, were to A, quickly ramp up. I would say there are three type of skills that, you know, skills or expectations. One is, you know, domain expertise, right? A little bit of, you know, the industry that you're working in. The second is, you know, hard skills such as Excel, PPT, and so on. And then there are soft skills, right? Like communications, right? Stakeholder management. Right, so these are, I think, the three groups of skills slash expectations that are there in a starting consulting job, and I think those three group of skills stay the same as you develop your career in consulting as well. I think just the stress on different things changes, right? So as a entry level analyst or something like that, you would be required to do a lot more of the hard skills parts like Excel modeling, right, analytics, PPT making, etc.
Then what was that one point in time where you decided that moving further won't yield me faster fruits? Rather than, you know, switching to going ISB, taking a PGDM degree, and then after that, you know, did you want to go into consulting before you chose ISB, or if that is something that you eventually figured out?
So, you know, while I was doing different types of consulting, I realized that strategy consulting was what I was most drawn towards. And I was also simultaneously doing a lot of research online, you know, looking at tech companies and their stories. And, you know, Sheryl Sandberg was someone I was really inspired by, right? She pretty much built Facebook from the ground up with Mark. And also in India, there was Radhika Gupta, right? And a lot of, you know, leaders like Sundar Pichai, etc. And I started to see the commonality between all of them being one company, which was McKinsey, right? I went back and checked a lot of notable alumni from there, got inspired by their stories, had actually a couple of friends who had been working in McKinsey, right? And so somehow, before going for my MBA, I had that in mind that maybe this would be a good place for me. And I realized that in a practical sense, to make that switch, right, an MBA would be the best stepping stone. Yeah, I was, you know, laser focused going into my MBA. And I actually recommend that for most people. It doesn't have to be this company, but I think you get the most out of an MBA when you have clarity of where you want to go post it. In fact, I would say don't do an MBA until you have clarity of this is what I want out of the MBA. I don't agree with that advice of like go there and figure it out. I mean, maybe it'll work, but MBAs are a lot of time and monetary investment to take that luck wala putt shot, right? You want to be clear, you want to be you want to be deliberate about what you want out of that, because an MBA for most people is once in a lifetime.
Right, because when you're going to collect stones, you would want to carry a bag with yourself because you have limited time to collect them.
Absolutely, absolutely. Right. And you're also leaving the workforce, right? You're not only paying for the MBA, you're also not getting salary, right? So you have to think about it both ways, right? It's a massive trade-off. Step one is knowing exactly what you want, right? Not just from a 2 or 3 year perspective, but from a 10 year perspective. Without MBA, what is my career going to look like? With MBA, what is my career going to look like? And if there is a significant difference, right? Only then go for that MBA, right? There are certain fields like coding, right? Software development, where a MBA like if you want to continue in coding, won't really add that much value. Yes, if you want to go from coding to being a product manager,
right.
Yes, then there is significant value, right? So you have to think of what is my career trajectory going to look like without an MBA versus with an MBA, right? Also a little bit of, you know, financial modeling around what could be my potential compensation increase, right, post MBA. Look at the median salaries of the colleges you're applying for, right? Compare and see how much is that compared to where I am today, right? And then see, you know, it's a cost benefit analysis, right, a basic right. thing, right? That this is over 10 years what I'm going to earn, right? And this is the fees I'm going to have to pay to get to that. Yes, there is, I want to do this, but then there is a strategy of how to get there, right? So I had spoken to multiple people to figure out what are my odds. What do I need to do from day one? I had a whole plan in place from day one that, hey, grades are important, right? Extracurriculars are important, right? I had a little bit lower work experience than most people at ISB, right? So I knew what I had to do to demonstrate leadership. So you need to have a plan in place, and all those things go into that strategy of how do I get to that job that I want, or how do I get to that, even if it's not immediate, right? I'm seeing this, and I had heard this while I was at ISB, that the job people leave ISB with, the job they get through placements, 50% people actually switch that to another job within a year. So having that end goal in mind is actually very important. Even if you don't get it directly after your MBA, you still continue working towards that even after your MBA.
I want to fast track this conversation to your current job, your current role at McKinsey.
Yeah.
So bigger roles and responsibilities.
Yeah.
And you mentioned that it's 6-7x the salary compared to your first job that you were getting, right? There's a narrative, and it's highlighted in the media as well, that life as a consultant is very hard. You have to work extra hard to, you know, put in work, because there are bigger roles and responsibilities. More things are expected out of you.
Sure.
And then you are fond of having a work-life balance, and then you manage to travel.
Yeah.
Do you get to enjoy the money that you make right now?
Yeah, I think life is hard as a consultant, right? But where is it not, right? So I think you have to have passion for it, right? Because it is, you know, it will be longer hours at some point. Right. So unless you are fond of that lifestyle, you're fond of that work, it fulfills you, it may start to weigh on you. So I therefore believe that people need to do the things that they like. Otherwise, it's going to every job is hectic nowadays. Right now, I do enjoy the travel quite a bit. Right. I think I've gotten to see different parts of India. Even gotten to travel to Europe as a part of my job, right?
Do you get time to enjoy when you're traveling? Do you get to, like, from your work, take out time to see certain places?
Yeah. In fact, you know, our teams are encouraged to do it, right? When we had traveled to Europe, I'll take an example, when we were in Paris, you know, our team had actually gone out quite a few dinners, right? We had taken some weekend trips even, right? All of us together. Because weekends, we are not expected to work. And of course, you know, you do it on your own time. You do it on your own budget. But, you know, while you're there, the teams are very open to, like, having fun.
Right.
You know, there is work that has to be done,
yeah.
right? But after that, you know, you actually go out even with clients. You go out with the team. You end up seeing the place, right? So you have to plan for it, right? I think you make it what you want to make it.
So right now, with the money that you're making, and after your MBA life, now you're a consultant, you're traveling to Europe, you know, you're having fun, you're visiting France. So what are some of the aspirational things that you purchased for yourself when in your first job back when you started were kind of big things?
Yeah.
Also, like, how has your lifestyle changed right now?
Yeah. So maybe I'll take the lifestyle part first. I think just in terms of lifestyle, I think there's more travel. Monday to Thursday-ish, I'm usually traveling, right? But that's also a choice, I know people who don't want to do that much of it, and they find projects that don't have so much of that, right? So it's a choice. I like doing it, right? Therefore, I choose projects that have more opportunities for travel, right? So that's a choice. Lifestyle, I now find, and I've been inspired by colleagues to do more meditation than before. I find it actually very, very helpful. I would add one more actually in terms of lifestyle changes. There was a time before my MBA where I used to go gaga over buffets, right? Like buffets used to be a huge thing, right? Now, like ghar ka khana is the best,
yeah.
Right? Like take me to the fanciest Michelin star restaurants. I will still want like dal chawal. I will still
food,
want exactly
yes.
like my ghar ka khana. And you know, it was exactly the opposite first. I used to look for opportunities to go out and eat, and I still enjoy food a lot, right? But now, you know, there is a special place in my heart for ghar ka khana, for mom's cooking, right? So that has been another lifestyle change. But if I had to say a very memorable purchase, there's a little bit of a personal story there. I think when I was back in school, there was this trend of like these big hoop earrings that had come out, and you know, I had asked my mom if she could buy me one, and you know, we bought like these fake big hoop earrings, and my mom would be like, you know, one day you buy me a real gold one when you start earning money and stuff, right? And recently, like, you know, I had gotten my bonus and I bought her these, you know, diamond studded big gold hoop earrings, and probably, you know, something I couldn't have purchased outright in the past. But fortunately, I'm very, very grateful that now I'm in a position where I financially can. And I bought those out for her, and, you know, she kind of had tears in her eyes. She remembered that exact incident. So I think that is a memorable purchase. It may have cost like a month's salary, but so worth it, right?